Hello and good evening all of you. A very very warm welcome to Byju's exam prep. Welcome to our daily quiz session. Now before starting our session for today, here is a quick announcement for all of you. If you want to crack UPSC Civil Services examination in our first attempt, then here we have a one-to-one counseling session. So if you want to be a part of it, then please, please fill a Google form, which is available in our description below and also in a pinned comment. So please ensure that you have filled your all details. Our mentor will definitely contact you. So let's start our session for today, daily quiz. So here is your first question on your screen. Consider the following statements. Okay, so here we have three statements. First statement is, K-shaped recovery implies divergent rate of recovery with one section recovering positively and other declining. Okay, second statement, the Gini coefficient is a commonly used measure of income inequality. Third statement, a higher Gini coefficient indicates greater income inequality. Okay, so now my dear students, you have to analyze how many of the above statement is or are correct here. Okay, only one, only two, all three or none. So how many statements are correct here? So let's see first statement here. K-shaped recovery implies divergent rate of recovery. Okay, it means one section is recovering positively and one section is declining. So first statement is absolutely right here. Second statement, Gini coefficient, this is not a new concept. I hope you have learned about this concept in your static part. So the Gini coefficient is a commonly used measure of income inequality. So second statement is also right. Third statement, a higher Gini coefficient indicates what? Greater income equality, inequality. So this is also right statement. So here all three statements are right. So C is the correct option. Now why this question? Because today we have a news in the Indian Express, and this topic can be related with your economy part. And what is the news here? So income inequality declines, says SBI research unit countering K-shaped eco recovery claims. So this is your news. Now what is the context here? So income inequality has declined recently in India with a higher tax base. It means about 36.3% of taxpayers have moved to higher income tax bracket. So this is your context here. That's why we came up with this question related to income inequality and Gini coefficient and K-shaped recovery also, because here this report also says that income inequality captured through the Gini coefficient. Okay, so on the basis of that, they are saying that this much taxpayers have moved from higher income, have moved from a lower income tax bracket to higher income tax bracket. So let's understand the context here, more about this K-shaped recovery here. So in the aftermath of a recession, K-shaped recovery materializes, showcasing varied rates, timings or extents of recovery across different facets of the economy, as you can see in this diagram here. Okay, like you can see one group is like recovering very positively, and on the other hand, small groups, okay, like for example small business, poor blue collar jobs, that like they are recovering very in a declining manner. So this is your K-shaped recovery. Okay, this diverges from a uniform and simultaneous recovery observed in sectors, industries or demographic groups. Okay, the implications of a K-shaped recovery extend beyond mere economic shifts, ushering in structural changes in the economy, because this broads, because if one group is like recovering very positively and one group is recovering in a declining way, then obviously it will bring what? Structural changes in the economy and society at large, as the dynamics of economic outcomes and relationships undergo what? Fundamental transformations pre and post recession. So this is the, you can say, consequence of this K-shaped recovery. Okay, now moving towards our next topic, which is your Gini coefficient here. So it is a very commonly used measure of income inequality. So that's why they are in the question. For second statement was right there. It ranges from 0 to 1. It means that if Gini coefficient is 0, then it means perfect equality. And if it is 1, then it means perfect inequality. So it means this is the highest number. Okay, and highest number shows what? Inequality. Income inequality. Okay, so third statement, that's why third statement was also right there. A higher Gini coefficient indicates what? Greater income inequality. Okay, now we have other tools also to measure inequality. Like for example, first is your Lorentz curve. Okay, this is a graphical representation of income distribution. It helps visualize how income is distributed across different population groups. Okay, so one, we have this Gini coefficient. Second one is Lorentz curve also. Third is this index. Okay, this index considers both within group and between group inequality. Okay, it provides a more nuanced understanding of the sources of inequality in a given population. And third one is Palma ratio. Okay, this ratio is a measure of income inequality that focuses on the income share of the richest 10% compared to the poorest 40% of the population. Okay, it helps highlight the disparities between the rich and poor. So please remember that all these shows what? Your income inequality. This is a very, very important topic for your economy part. Okay, so please, please read about it very, very carefully. Now moving towards our second question here. So consider the following statements regarding European Free Trade Association, EFTA. Okay, so first statement here is EFTA countries are not part of the European Union. Okay, second statement, it excludes Iceland, Liechtenstein, Norway and Switzerland. Okay, which of the above statement is or are correct here? Okay, first only, second only, both one and two, neither one nor two. So which statement is correct here? So first statement is right. Okay, second statement is wrong here because it includes all these countries. Okay, EFTA includes all these countries. So that's why here the correct option is first only. Okay, so first statement is right, second statement is wrong here. Now why this question here? Let's see the news here. So this news has been picked up from the Indian Express newspaper, and this question can be related to your economy part also, international relations also. Why? Because Switzerland decision to eliminate import duties limits FTA utility for India. Okay, this is the news in the today's Indian Express paper. Now, Switzerland policy to allow tariff-free entry for all industrial goods from all country significantly limits what? India's prospects of profit from India and the EFTA free trade agreement that has been recently negotiated. And here you can see that EFTA description is also there. So basically in this news, what is more important for you is like India and Switzerland trade relations, okay, their bilateral relations also. And one more thing is important is this EFTA. And you can see here EFTA countries are not part of the European Union. So that's why their first statement was right. So this is a explanation of your first statement. Then second statement, please be read carefully. EFTA comprises your Iceland, Liechtenstein, Norway and Switzerland. Okay, and this is an intergovernmental organization for the promotion and intensification of free trade. Okay, so this is the description of this EFTA, and this is very, very important for your exam. Now please see this trade relations also. India's exports to EFTA countries during 2022 to 2023 stood at $1.92 billion as against $1.74 billion in 2021 to 2022. So it means it has marginally what? Increased here. Okay, imports aggregated at $16.74 billion during the last fiscal as compared to $25.5 billion in 2021. So this has decreased. Okay, so imports has decreased, but yeah, exports have been increased. So this is all about your EFTA. Now moving towards your third question, consider the following statements regarding hypersonic missiles. Okay, so first statement, both ballistic and hypersonic missiles follow a ballistic trajectory and can be maneuvered to the intended target. Okay, second statement, conventional hypersonic missiles use only potential energy. Okay, third statement, it flies at least at the speed of Mach 10. Okay, so how many of the above statement is or are correct here? Only one, only two, all three or none? Okay. So first statement is wrong here. Okay. Second statement is also wrong here. Third statement is also wrong here. So here the correct option is what? None. None of these statements are correct here. Now let's see why these statements are wrong here. But before that, we have to see like why this question came up in front of us. So why? Because today there is a news in your Indian Express, and this question can be related to your international relations also and defense technology also. Now here, you don't need to like focus much, you don't need to focus on this news holistically, but yeah, just a headline is sufficient for you. So Russia fires hypersonic missiles on Ukraine. This is just a news for you. Now for us, what is more important here is this hypersonic missiles, okay, related to your defense technology. Okay, so let's see defense technology, hypersonic missiles. So hypersonic missiles, yeah, reaching a minimum speed of Mach 10. Okay, so third statement, what was written there? March 10. So that's why that statement was wrong. So here the speed of this hypersonic missile is March 10, which is equivalent to 5 times the speed of sound. Okay, hypersonic missiles distinguish themselves from ballistic counterparts by avoiding a ballistic trajectory. That's why first statement was also wrong there. Actually, in that case, it showed that both of them are similar. But actually, both of them are very, very different. This allows them to be steered towards their desired targets. That is true. Traditional hypersonic weapons only use what? Kinetic energy, not potential energy. And my dear students, you have to share, you have to drop a comment related to this difference between kinetic energy and potential energy. I hope you have learned in you have learned these concepts in your general science. So please mention that, like, what is the difference between these two and what they are exactly. Okay, so these traditional hypersonic weapons use which energy? Kinetic energy. Okay. Now moving towards our fourth question, and more importantly, if I tell you countries also, so please mention that also, like how many countries have this hypersonic missiles. Okay, so you have to share two answers. First is the difference between kinetic energy and potential energy, and my second question is like how many countries and which countries have this hypersonic missiles. So please share your answers in the comment section. Our team will definitely evaluate them. So consider the following statements regarding rule of law. Okay, so first statement here is, it means the exclusion of the existence of arbitrariness on part of the government. Second statement, it acts as a check to the executive lawlessness by ensuring that no official or administrator can arrest or detain a person without legislative sanction. Okay, so which of the above statement is or are correct here? First only, second only, both one and two, neither one nor two. Okay, so here both of these are correct. So this statement is also right. This statement is also right. So that's why both statements are right here. Now why this news here? Why this question? So let's see the context here. Yeah. So this news is there in the Indian Express, though it's there in your front page also, in your explained section also, and in mid of that also. And this question can be related to your polity part. So what is the context here? So first of all, rule of law versus right to liberty, right to liberty, what court has said. Okay, so here, while questioning the Gujarat's government decision to grant remission to the convicts in the Bilkis Bano case, the Supreme Court on Monday acknowledged the importance of this personal liberty as a fundamental right of this article number 21. So my dear students, here you have to see, like, see, article number 21 also came in this news. So first of all, you have to analyze this Bilkis Bano case. Okay, this is all, this is everywhere in your newspaper. So just read the context here. And more importantly, just go through with your static part also. Okay, so it doesn't mean it's okay newspaper on the one hand and static knowledge on other side. No, you have to combine both of them. Okay, so whenever you are reading your current affairs from your newspaper or from any website, you have to keep your static knowledge with yourself. Okay, so like in this news, you can see that Bilkis Bano, the recent judgment, is on the other hand. But here, you have to see like what static part is there. So first is article number 21. So please read about it, because it is every time in the news. And it's very important to like habits knowledge. Okay, so article number 21 of the constitution but also sought to address the question of whether the rule of law can prevail over it. So second concept which came here is rule of law. Okay, so rule of law and in fact preamble also, because see preamble, why? Because preamble, one of the main you can say feature of this preamble is justice also, liberty also. So that's why one thing you have to remember is with this news, article number 21, you have to like brush up. Second is rule of law also. And third is your preamble also. And I hope you know that these are your part of your basic structure of your constitution also. So fourth concept you have to read is basic structure of your constitution. Okay. So how many? Article number 21. Okay. Then preamble. Then rule of law, and then basic structure of your constitution. Okay, so all these concepts you have to read. Okay, these are very, very important. So now what is the news here? Let's see. So yeah, it also addressed the issue of whether the convicts should be sent back to prison or be given the benefits of liberty despite the orders forming the basis for their release. So here you can also read about what? Punitive detention also. Okay. Okay, then so this is how you have to read the news. Okay. Like you're reading the news on the same hand, you also have to read your static portion also. You have to cover these much topics also. Okay, so this is all about your rule of law related news. Now let's see what is exactly this rule of law. So Chief Justice Edward Coke of England, who held office during the reign of King James I, is considered to be the originator of doctrine. Which doctrine? This rule of law. Okay. Justice Coke, while emphasizing the supremacy of law against the executive, stated that the king should be under God and law. Okay. So this is what? Britishers. So when it got original? In the land of Britishers. Okay. The theory of Justice Coke was developed by Dicey in his classic work, The Law and the Constitution, which was published in the year 1885. Okay. Rule of law. Now, what is this rule of law according to Dicey? Means that absolute supremacy or predominance of regular law as opposed to the influence of arbitrary power or wide discretionary power. So basically it cancels what? Arbitrary power and discretionary powers, and it establishes what? Supremacy of law. Okay, so this is the concept of this rule of law, and moreover it means that exclusion of the existence of any arbitrariness on part of the government. So that's why their first statement was right. Okay, this in essence means that no man can be arrested, punished, or be lawfully made to suffer in body or in goods except by the due process of law. It means that if you have committed some illegal activity, okay, by due process of law, you will get a punishment. But if you have not done that, so you will not be imprisoned. Okay, so or if someone has committed any breach of law established in the ordinary legal manner before the ordinary courts of the land. So this is all about this rule of land. Okay. Oh, sorry. Rule of law. Okay. Now, PYQ of today's. So today we have picked a previous year question from 2022 question paper. Now here we have a match the following, but in the another format here, because you know that you, in 2022 and 23 UPSC gave a different pattern. And here our question is, consider the following pairs, and here in the first column we have the sites of Ashoka's major rock edicts. Okay, and here we have a modern day states. So Dholi, Odisha, Iragudi, Andhra Pradesh, Jaugada, Madhya Pradesh, Kalsi, Karnataka. Okay, how many pairs given above are correctly matched here? Okay, so this is your question here. Only one, only two, only three, all four pairs. So my dear students, here Dholi is in Odisha, this is right. Iragudi is in Andhra Pradesh, this is also right. But Jaugada, Madhya Pradesh, wrong. Kalsi in Karnataka, wrong. So how many pairs are correct here? Only two pairs. So which option is right here? B. Only two pairs. Okay. Now let's see the context here. So Dholi, as I said, it is in Odisha. Okay. And the archaeological excavation dates back to 3rd century BCE, specifically during the era of Ashoka. So in 2013 also, this Iragudi, it was again ASI took some measures to safeguard this territory. And that's why we came to know that this Iragudi is in Andhra Pradesh, in Kurnool district. Okay. Jaugada is in Odisha actually. Okay. So as it is written here, Madhya Pradesh, no, it is in Odisha. And this is also there near to like Uttaranchal, modern day, and your Himachal Pradesh. Okay, so that's why your fourth pair is also wrong. So as you can see there, your Kalsi, okay, though Ashoka edict is there, but yeah, it conveys a human approach adopted by Ashoka after embracing Buddhism. So basically it gives the doctrine given by Ashoka when after he embraces Buddhism religion, and it is situated in the buffer zone between Uttaranchal and Himachal Pradesh. Okay, so this is all about your previous year question. Now we have another fact of the day, and this has been picked up from your Indian Express newspaper. So geographical indication tag, again it is a very very important topic, and you can expect some match the following or pairs question or some like statement based questions also. So that's why this geographical indication tag is very very important for your prelims exam. And like, what is the news here recently? So 7 products from Odisha have bagged the coveted GI tag, which recognizes their exclusivity to the state. Okay, so here you can see that 7 products description is there in your newspaper. So so let's understand first of all, what is this GI tag? Yeah. So what is this GI tag? So GI tag is a sign assigned to products that have a specific geographical origin. So please understand here. First of all, what is the condition here? Geographical location. Geographical origin. Okay. And some intrinsic qualities also. Please observe these keywords. Okay. So here, yeah, so GI tag is a sign assigned to products that have a specific geographical origin and possesses their intrinsic qualities due to said origin. Okay, they assure consumers of the quality and authenticity of the product while protecting interest of local producers. Okay, so what is the aim basically? Protects interest of local producers. Okay, then in India, GI tag are awarded by which department? Department for Promotion of Industry and Internal Trade, and this comes under which ministry? Ministry of Commerce and Industry. So this is very very important here. Okay, your Department of Promotion for Industry, your Department for Promotion of Industry and Internal Trade, Ministry of Commerce and Industry. Okay, so this is very very important. Now so GI registration is given to an area, not a trader. Okay, so please remember that those dealing with the GI tag product can apply to sell with the GI logo also. So whatever, so if your product got a GI tag, then you have to produce with a GI logo. Okay, authorized traders are then each assigned a unique GI number also. Crucially, unauthorized traders can be prosecuted under the Geographical Indications of Goods Registration and Protection Act of 1999. Okay, so here we have a 7 products from Odisha which bagged the GI tag last Thursday. It means last week. So this is all about your context here. So this is a very very important one. Your GI tag, like how it gets, and GI number about, and which act is important for us. So this act of 1999 and which ministry is there. So these facts are very very important. Now moving towards our products here. So yeah, so first product is Kapda Ganda shawl. Okay, so Kapda Ganda shawl, here you can see the image also. So woven and embroidered by the women of the which tribe? Dongriya Kond tribe. So again, in each line you will find a fact, a very, very important fact. So, which tribe is involved here? Dongria Kond tribe, particularly PYIG, okay, particularly vulnerable tribal group in the Niyamgiri Hills in Odisha. So, in fact, UPSC can also ask you about this tribe, and they can ask you like in which state they are, or they can give you in the match the following format, and then they can also ask you about this tribe. So Dongria Kond tribe is where? It is a PVTG first of all, and second is it is in Odisha, and they do what? They embroider or they wove this shawl, okay, Kabda Ganda shawl, and the shawl reflects the rich tribal heritage of this tribe, okay, Dongria Kond's tribe, and it is embroidered on an off-white coarse cloth. As you can see here, this is an off-white cloth with red, yellow and green color threads. As you can see here, red, yellow and green threads are there in this shawl, with each color holding significance. Okay, green, now here green symbolizes what? Mountains and hills, okay, means they are related to nature. Yellow stands for peace and happiness, and red stands as a symbol of blood. Okay, so this is all about this shawl. Moreover, the motifs in the shawl, as you can see here, some motifs are also there. Okay, some triangles, mostly lines and triangles, believed to be the reflection of the importance of mountains for the community. Okay, the shawl is worn by both men and women, and the Dongrias gifted to their family members as a token of love and affection. So please, please hear what is important for us. First of all, this shawl is very, very important, and UPSC can also ask you about this shawl, like where this shawl is like embroidered or woven, or like which tribes does that. Moreover, this tribe is also very, very important. So both of them are important. So please, please make a note of it. Then next, your GI Tech product is Lungia Sora painting. Okay, now here you can see this beautiful painting. Okay, it's have a very beautifully like painted, and it has how many colors? Red is there, white is there, some blackish is also there. So let's understand about this painting. So the painting is one of the oldest tribal art forms, and it is known as Iditaal. Okay, so it is also known as Iditaal. Okay, now the artworks are famous for their beauty, aesthetics, ritualistic association and iconography. Okay, the art form belongs to the, again, which community? Lungia Sora community, again PVTG. So again a tribal group. They reside where? Rayagada district. Okay, these paintings are in the form of exterior murals painted on the mud walls of home. Okay, white paintings figure over a crimson maroon background. Okay, as you can see here, maroon background is there. So it is believed that the Lungia Soras, means this community, PVTG community, paint their walls with Iditaal artworks to show gratitude to their deities and forefathers. Okay, so what is the aim? To show a gratitude and reflecting the love and affection of the primitive tribes for nature. They feature subjects like tribal humans. Okay, as you can see here, humans are there, animals are there, birds and sun and the moon. Okay, so these are the motifs. Okay. Now, third one, Koraput Kala Jeera rice. Okay, the black colored rice variety, also known as the Prince of Rice. Okay, so this black colored one is also known as what? Prince of Rice. Okay, is famous for its aroma, taste, texture and nutritional value. Okay, tribal farmers of the Koraput region have preserved the rice variety for around 1,000 years. Okay, as the rice grains resemble cumin seeds, it is also called as Kala Jeera. So here we have one more name, Kala Jeera, and it is also known as what? Prince of the rice. Okay, consumption of this rice variety helps in increasing hemoglobin levels and improves metabolism in the body. Okay, fourth one, Odisha Khajuri Guda. Okay, so Odisha's Khajuri Gud or Jaggery is a natural sweetener extracted from date palm, khajur means, and has its origin in the Gajapati district. Okay, traditionally the jaggery is prepared in a trapezoidal from a form called patali gud, and is organic by nature. It is dark brown and has a unique taste also. Okay, so all of them are from Odisha only. Now, Simply Pal Kai chutney. Now this is a very unique kind of a chutney. Can you imagine some chutney made up from ants? Yeah, this is that chutney. So this chutney is made with red weaver ants, is a traditional delicacy of the tribals in Odisha, Mayurbhanj district. So this is made up of from red ants. Okay, so these ants are found in the forest of Mayurbhanj, including the your Simlipal forest also, Asia's second largest biosphere. Again, a very very important fact. Okay, rich in medicinal and nutritional value, the chutney is believed to be a good source of nutrients like protein, calcium, zinc, vitamin B12, iron, magnesium, potassium, etc. Now you can see that red ants are very very useful for you. Okay, so if you can make a chutney, you will get many many nutrients and many many vitamins also. So Mayurbhanj tribals also earn their livelihood by selling this red ants chutney made from the ants. They believe that its consumption helps boost immunity and prevents disease also. Now the last one, Nayagarh Kanti Mundi Brinjal. Okay, so this Nayagarh Kanti Mundi Brinjal is known for its prickly thorns on the stems and the whole plant. The green and round fruits contain more seeds as compared to other genotypes. Okay, it is famous for its unique taste and relatively short quick cooking time. The plants are resistant to major insects and can be grown into minimal pesticide also. It is being widely cultivated in your Nayagarh district of the state. Okay, the growers are getting a yield of up to 200 quintals per hectare and selling at around rupees 60 per kg. Okay, historical records also suggest that the locals got the brinjal from the hilly areas. Okay, they collected seeds from it and started raising seedlings nearly 100 years ago. One more is there, and this is your then Kanal Magji. Okay, then Kanal Magji is a type of sweet made from cheese from buffalo milk with characteristics of appearance, taste, flavor, shape and size. Okay, it also has a unique traditional nutritional values that distinguish it from other cheese based sweets. Okay, thousands of people were said to be earning their livelihood through animal husbandry, especially buffalo rearing during the British era. Okay, the region was the hinterland of buffalo milk, milk production, and cheese was the third largest produce after milk or and curd. Okay, Mandar's Sadangi area of Gondia block is believed to be the center of origin of the sweet stuff, which has now been spread to the entire district. Okay, the sweet is prepared by draining moisture from the cheese and then frying it, finally forming balls from the mixture. Okay, so this is all about your session for today. Again, a quick announcement for all of you. If you want to crack UPSC Civil Services examination in our first attempt, then please fill our Google form, which is available in our pinned comment and a description box below. Thank you so much for attending this session. Goodbye and take care.